currently, gene therapy clinical trials for hemophilia are using the same strategy that is based on adeno-associated viral factor, the AAV, containing the factor VIII or factor IX transgene. These AAV vectors are administered intravenously, and due to their tropism to liver cells, the hepatocytes are the main transduced cells that, with the efficient gene transfer, are able to express and secrete either factor VIII or factor IX in the circulation. It is important to note that this strategy has some advantages, such as the ability of in vivo administration and the capacity to deliver several genome copies per cell, which improves the gene therapy efficiency. However, it has also some disadvantages, such as the limited capacity for encoding the transgene. Also, the potential effect to lose or dilute the transgene when the cells are dividing. The immunogenicity involving AAV vector, which may decrease the transduction efficacy due to the presence of pre-neutralizing AAV antibody, or the risk of anti-capsid immune response that may affect the transgene expression, and the potential for hepatotoxicity. The first question is, how long will the therapeutic benefit last? So let's talk about the durability of transgene expression after AAV-mediated hemophilia gene therapy. The gene therapy durability data is limited to what we know from some preclinical studies involving large animals, such as the canine hemophilia gene therapy studies that report the persistent expression for 10 to 12 years in adult dogs. In terms of clinical trials, we have so far some phase I and II studies. We've reported 8 years of follow-up after hemophilia B gene therapy, demonstrating stable factor IX expression. For hemophilia A gene therapy, we have now more than 4 years of follow-up, and we will briefly discuss the outcomes that we have so far. At the end of 2011, it was published by Professor Amit Natawamy the first results of this new generation of hemophilia gene therapy from the phase I and II hemophilia B gene therapy trial using an AAV8 vector encoding the codon-optimized factor IX. And according to the last public available information, the patients from the high-dose cohort, 2 times 10 to 12, they still maintain a stable median factor IX expression of more than 5% for more than 6.7 years. We have also results from other hemophilia B gene therapy clinical trials, such as the phase I and II SPARC9001 using factor IX Padua transgene. And as we can see here, despite the large variability of the factor IX expression, at the high dose cohort, that is 5 times 10 to 11, shows a mean steady state factor IX expression of more than 33.7% during the first year. Here we are shown the new generation of hemophilia B gene therapy clinical trials with the 3 current studies in light green. As we can see, the ongoing trials are all using factor IX Padua transgene, with median factor IX expression close to the normal range. As we already discussed, the first patient from the University College of London and St. Jude trial, they have now more than 8 years of follow-up maintaining factor IX expression. Related to hemophilia A gene therapy durability, one important example is the phase I and II BMN270 trial from BioMarin using AAV5 and factor VIII SQ transgene. In this graph is demonstrated in green the 7 patients who received the high dose, 6 times 10 to 13 VG per kg. At the end of the first year of follow-up, the mean factor VIII expression was 64%, measuring with the chromogenic assay, which demonstrates to result in 1.6 times lower factor VIII activity than one-stage assay. However, as we can notice from the year 2 to 4, these patients had a decrease in the factor VIII expression, with a mean factor VIII expression of 24.2% at the end of the fourth year of follow-up. However, it is also important to notice that here we are discussing a limited number of patients, only 7, and all these patients are still out of prophylaxis with factor VIII or any other hemostatic products. And the majority, 6 out of 7, are not reporting any bleeding event during the 4 years of follow-up. In this table, we also have all hemophilia A gene therapy clinical trials, and in green are the 5 ongoing studies in different phases. As we discussed, some trials, especially the ones with early follow-up phase, 1 or 2 years, achieved the median factor VIII expression close or at the normal range. However, as observed in the BioMarin trial, there was a decrease in the factor VIII activity that started at the second year of follow-up, and it seems to be stable during the following year until year 4. And again, here we are discussing a limited number of patients. There are some possible factors that may influence on the durability of factor VIII and factor IX expression. And this can include the transgene dilution effect due to the cells that are dividing, where only one of the daughter cells will receive the transgene. Once AAV vector is a non-integrating vector and the transgene forms an episomal element in the transduced cells outside the cell genome. We can also observe the loss of transgene due to cell death or gene silence. This can occur as a result of the immune response against the AAV capsid, hepatocyte turnover, promoter silencing, and liver toxicity. Related to hemophilia gene therapy safety, it is interesting to review the CoreHeme project that was developed with several stakeholders involving in hemophilia care, including patients, clinicians, payers, and in this project was defined some of the main efficacy and safety domains that may help to close evaluate gene therapy outcomes. Regarding the safety domains, we have here the short-term possible adverse events, including liver toxicity, inhibitor development, immune response, the risk for thrombosis. And the long-term adverse events that we will briefly discuss here, including the risk of the development of other disorders, vector integration into the host genome, duration of vector neutralizing antibodies, and of course, to monitor and evaluate any cause of death. Related to the risk to genotoxicity due to the vector integration into the host genome, it was already demonstrated that a low percentage of AAV integration events may occur in small and large animals and also in humans after they receive AAV vector. One particular study using mice model with a specific AAV integration locus that is absent in humans showed that some neonatal mice develop hepatocellular carcinoma. On the other hand, we also have a long-term follow-up of preclinical studies using large animals like dogs that demonstrated that AAV integration can occur. However, no malignancies were observed in more than 10 years of follow-up with these dogs. In another study involving hemophilia B patients that received the AAV vector directed to liver, with now more than 15 years of follow-up, it was recently published that no liver toxicity or tumorigenesis was observed. However, it is important to note that in December 2020, One hemophilia B patient from the phase 3 HOPE-B trial, AMT-061, that received the AAV5 factor 9 IPADUA in October 2019 had the preliminary diagnosis of hepatocellular carcinoma. It is also important to observe that this patient also has other possible risk factors associated with hepatocellular carcinoma, including the chronic history of hepatitis C and hepatitis B infection, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, and advanced age. Of course, this particular case needs to be clarified, but also demonstrated the importance to closely follow patients for short and long term after they receive gene therapy, not only in clinical trials, but also when these gene therapies became commercially available. Regarding other long-term safety concerns, well, one of the risks can be related to the transgene. What we observed so far is that no patients had evidence to develop inhibitor to factor 8 or factor 9. But it's also true that all hemophilia A and hemophilia B that were enrolled in clinical trials had low risk factors for inhibitor development. On the other hand, some preclinical studies suggested that gene therapy may be an effective alternative for the immune tolerance induction for patients with history or presence of inhibitor, which needs to be demonstrated. Regarding the risk for thrombosis due to factor 8 or factor 9 overexpression, these have been also closely monitored. In one hemophilia B clinical trial, the BMAs, one hemophilia B patient with other risk factors for thrombosis developed a thrombosis of arteriovenous fistula when his factor 9 expression was higher than 280%. This patient received transient anticoagulation and the event was resolved. Related to the duration of vector neutralizing response, we know that the presence of AAV vector neutralizing antibody may persist for a long period of time, as demonstrated here, 15 years after these patients received the administration of AAV2 vector in a hemophilia B clinical trial. We also observed in these three patients that the cross-reactivity to other AAV serotypes was detected, what may impact in administration of any other AAV vector. However, recent clinical trials suggest that AAV neutralizing antibody may not affect factor expression, as the recent results of the phase 1, 2, and phase 3 hemophilia B gene therapy AMT-060 and AMT-061 that enrolled patients with different titers of AAV5 neutralizing antibody without correlation to the efficacy of factor 9 expression. We also have several preclinical studies that are evaluating alternatives to overcome the pre-existing AAV neutralizing antibodies. To guarantee that all relevant efficacy and safety outcomes related to hemophilia gene therapy are properly evaluated, it is important to have in place a long-term data collection, such as some of the gene therapy registries recently proposed by World Federation of Hemophilia, with a comprehensive core data set, including several safety and efficacy parameters. In summary, recent hemophilia gene therapy clinical trials have shown promising results and suggest that gene therapy has the potential to become a safe and cost-effective therapeutic alternative. Related to long-term durability, we still need to follow the clinical trials as they achieved a longer follow-up period. We have observed that factor expression can persist for more than 10 years in canine gene therapy studies and for more than 8 years in hemophilia B clinical trial. For hemophilia A clinical trial, we have recently 4 years of follow-up, but we still need more data to evaluate the results across the trials. Related to the long-term safety concerns, we still need to closely evaluate the potential risk, especially for genotoxicity. And we don't know yet if the persistence of AAV neutralizing antibody will definitely interfere to preclude repeated AAV vector infusions. We may need to see different alternatives. And there is no doubt that gene therapy registry are crucial and may help to evaluate rare events and determine long-term safety, durability, and efficacy. With that, I would like to thank you your attention. Thank you very much.
Please take this quick post-test.
Which of the following is not likely to be a factor in the long-term expression of factor 8 or factor 9 following AAV-mediated liver-directed gene therapy? Based on available information, which of the following statements regarding the long-term safety of gene therapy for hemophilia is not accurate?
Hello, in this presentation, we will discuss long-term outcomes and professor at University of Campinas and director of this Hemocentrinic Clinical Studies, São Paulo State University.
The results that we have so far from hemophilia today, the long-term outcomes of gene therapy in hemophilia and possible factors that may interfere with the long-term factor 8 or factor 9 expression. We will also discuss long-term safety, including genotoxicity, transgene-related risks, and the impact of persistent AAV neutralizing antibody, and of course, the importance to have global gene therapy registries.